Well, hello everyone. I'm Dr. Nick Delgado. It's great to see you. We're going to have a lot of fun tonight. We're going to talk about what we need to do to prepare ourselves to get into incredible health and shape emotionally and physically. Dr. Lionel King flew in all the way from the East Coast. Give us a little bit about your background so we can share with the audience.
Well, I'm an internal medicine physician. I live in Naples, Florida, and my background is in hospitalist medicine. So I take care of people at their sickest. I did my training at University of Wisconsin in Madison, Wisconsin. I did my internal medicine residency at Johns Hopkins Sinai Hospital in Baltimore, Maryland. And so I'm a traditional doc that takes care of sick patients in the hospital. I admit them in the hospital, I coordinate their care, get them well, get them out of the hospital and back to their primary care docs and arrange the follow-up. And so, you know, that's one side of what I do. And the other side of what I do is I prevent people from getting into the hospital in the first place, and really teaching people how to take back control over their health and do the right things to prevent illness and live their best.
Well, Dr. King, with your experience and everything you had shared with me 2 days ago, you had a personal tragedy in your life, and it was a very personal, that is a direct, I believe it was your father.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that was the turning point in your philosophy and your career, wasn't it?
Yeah, definitely.
What happened?
Well, my dad was my hero. I mean, he was the, you know, if anyone could do anything, he could do it. He had this winning attitude. You know, he was a plumber by trade. He actually dropped out of high school to take care of his family. He was 13. He was number 13 of 13 siblings. And he got his GED, took up plumbing, married my mom, they moved out to L.A., and he actually became a pretty sought-after plumber in L.A. He was pretty famous out there. And so I was born in Los Angeles, and he decided that Los Angeles wasn't the best place, you know, for African-American males to grow up. The odds just weren't, you know, weren't that great. So where did he decide to move us? Alabama. And so we moved to Alabama. It was like the Beverly Hillbillies in reverse. It was not, we knew nothing about living, like, you know, in the country. But he wanted to, like, live a healthy life. You know, he wanted the clean air, not the smog. He wanted to grow his own vegetables. He wanted to raise his own livestock. And he didn't want the stress of living in a big city. And so there's many comical stories, but I remember, you know, he had these dairy cows. And he was all proud of his dairy cows because he's like, we're never going to have to go to the store again. We're going to have our own milk. We're going to have our own eggs and everything like that. And so he's all proud of his dairy cows. They were little calves because the, you know, grown cows were too expensive. So he got the calves. And he was all proud of them. And they had the neighbors over. And so they were just laughing, right? And so he's like, what are you laughing at? You know, he's like, well, you're not going to get any milk out of those. He's like, what do you mean? They're dairy cows. They're black and white and everything.
Uh-oh.
They're both bulls.
I was thinking that.
My mom's out there washing the hogs off. They keep getting dirty. They keep getting dirty. It was pretty funny. I was probably 10 years old at the time, so I didn't need TV. But I just lived with my parents, and it was pretty comical. And so I thought we were living healthy. You know, like, you know, my dad was like, you know, built. He didn't have to like go to the gym and work out. He just worked out in the field and everything like that. My mom rode horses and. We had a little country convenience store. She worked that by day and sold insurance by night. And you know, I thought we were the, you know, we were doing well. But come to find out that, you know, we still were doing all the wrong things. We thought we were doing the right things, but, you know, we're still eating, you know, mostly, you know, meats and fried foods, the southern cooking and everything like that. So I remember I was in my residency and my mom called me and said, you know, my dad was having some indigestion and went to the doctor, and the doctor said that he had a mass on his pancreas. So I was in residency at the time, so I knew exactly what that meant, a mass on his pancreas. So I said, Mom, are you sure this is pancreas, you know, not like prostate or anything? And I said, no, I think he said pancreas. So instantly I knew if this was pancreatic cancer, that was a 4-month death sentence, you know. So here's my hero, you know, the best man at my wedding, the man that I thought was invincible, and my mom is telling me that he has 4 months to live. And she didn't even know what she was telling me. So I had to fly home and explain this, you know, to my dad and to my mom. Probably one of the hardest things that I had to do.
Right.
And he wanted to fight it and do whatever he could. And so we got the best oncologist, the best surgeon. He had this horrendous surgery called a Whipple procedure. And he was in the hospital for one whole month. You know, he was drugged up on morphine. He couldn't eat. He was in bed for so long that he literally had to learn how to walk again. And, you know, he made it through the surgery. And the surgeon said, well, we got, you know, all the mass out, but likely there's still cancer cells there, and, you know, he's going to need chemotherapy. And my dad was like, absolutely not. I've gone through too much suffering. I'm not doing that. So I said, okay, well, you know, Pop, what do you want to do? So I still want to fight it. I don't want to just lay down and die, but I'm not, you know, going through chemotherapy. They say it's probably not, you know, really going to, you know, do much anyway. It's just going to make me sick. So I went online and I looked up, you know, alternative ways of fighting this, and I found the Optimum Health Institute in San Diego. And so, you know, me and Dad, we packed up and went. Now, all this time, I left residency. You don't just leave Johns Hopkins, you know.
Right.
And I said, you know, I gotta go take care of my dad through all this. And so, we both enrolled in the institute for a couple weeks. He ended up getting sick. He had fluid that built up on his lungs, malignant pleural effusion, and we only were able to stay a week. But during that week, I learned more about health and vitality and wellness than all my years in medical school or residency. Because in medical school and residency, we learn how to deal with disease.
Right.
You know, the disease after it already happens. Mm-hmm. And that's really what we studied. We didn't really study anything about nutrition. We didn't, you know, we might have spent, you know, one day, you know, or half a day on nutrition. We didn't really talk about hydration and the different things that you're supposed to do to support your body. Definitely didn't talk about the spiritual aspect of the body.
Right.
You know, nothing like that. And I remember my dad looking up at me, you know, he had lost all his weight, he had sunken eyes, and he says, wow, if only I would have known about this. And, you know, I said to him, I said, me too, you know, me too. And so here I was, helpless, you know, went to one of the best medical schools, went to one of the best residencies, and I couldn't even save mom and dad. So we had to fly back home, and, I enrolled him in hospice, and he passed away, you know, about probably a month later, which was right at, you know, the 4 month mark. And so it was at that time that I realized that my father was taken from me from a preventable disease. And many people don't realize that cancer is preventable. Mm-hmm. Many people don't realize that heart attacks and strokes and diabetes, all these things are preventable. And it was, you know, it really hit me hard, and I felt like I must get this message out to people. I didn't want my dad to die just for nothing. And so I wanted to really let people know that there are alternatives.
So Dr. King, when we look at examples of Steve Jobs, obviously the founder of Apple, and you know, we hear the stories how he apparently suddenly contracted pancreatic cancer. And yet, Dr. John McDougall, a good friend, he wrote a very extensive review of his case. He went back through the medical literature regarding Steve Jobs. And they found out that early on, when he had a series of certain tests, there were some suspicious things going on with some of the laboratory findings. And they suspected when they looked back that that's probably when he was in his late 20s where he first contracted pancreatic cancer. And they even theorized that something to do with the fact that he was assembling computers, and in those days they would solder without masks, and they were breathing in literally toxic lead and the different metals and things, heavy metals that are associated with, you know, just assembly of these computers were pretty archaic. I mean, he was one of the early pioneers. They were experimenting with computers before they became, you know, massively destructive and so forth. But he seemed to have contracted the early signs of the cancer, and as the cells began, as Dr. McDougall pointed out, when you look at most cases of cancer, there's a 20-year etiology. In other words, if you go back 20 years, that's probably when the person first contracted, and at the first cell, where there's a mutated cell or some kind of exposure to a toxin, or maybe years of improper eating and excessive fats and meats and carcinogenic byproducts. I mean, even Colin Campbell talks about in the China study how they looked at people in the Philippines where some of the Filipinos were eating lots of meat, and they looked at other islanders that weren't eating lots of meat, and they found a direct correlation to liver cancer in the meat consumption. And it wasn't so much even just the fat, it was the protein consumption. There was something going on about protein. And then they went and did experiments with animals, and they fed them a lot of protein, and the animals, when they were given an element that might cause cancer, developed full-blown liver cancer and went on to die. They then took a group of animals and exposed them to the same agent under the same conditions, but as they developed liver cancer, they switched them over to plant-based diets. And most of those animals survived. Mm-hmm. Much like the theory of optimum health. They get people sometimes if it's not too late, if not a week or a month before the end stage, and they'll put them basically on, as we know, a raw foods, plant-based diet, rich in enzymes and nutrients. And as we are starting to believe that there's a greater role in what we define as epigenetics, the environment around the cells, mm-hmm. rather than the genetics we're born with. So just because right. we might think your father had pancreatic cancer, that inevitably you may have a higher risk. And even if you have a sensitivity or a tendency, so long as you don't go to the same refrigerator, which is really the only genetics that would exist, is right. eating the same poor patterns and habits. And yet we hear of cases like Angela Jolie, who recently went through massive surgery, mastectomy, and I believe she even submitted to ovarian hysterectomy to remove all her ovaries. And even though she didn't have even any sign of cancer, but a geneticist said, according to this genetic study, you're at risk for breast cancer. Therefore, let's remove your breasts, mm-hmm. full mastectomy, and let's remove essentially your ovaries. Mm-hmm. So those of us who believe that we might have more control over our bodies and strengthen our bodies and our immune system, I think now that you've had this experience, where are you at with this public situation with Angela Jolie and all that's going on right now?
Well, there's a lot of fear that's associated with the unknown. Mm-hmm. And I think that people are misdirected. And this fear campaign is causing people to do drastic measures, you know, like Jolie. I think that people don't realize that they have control. Even if you have the genetics, the gene or the mutation, it still has to be turned on.
Right.
And it has the ability to be turned off. They're like light switches.
Correct.
You know? Mm-hmm. And so the China study talked about that. They took people that had genes or something that, you know, that put them at high risk for cancer and changed their diet, and that turned either, you know, off the gene if they were on the plant-based protein diet, or turned the gene on, you know, if they're on the animal protein-based diet. And so we can control these things. And that is what really, that's what led me to be on this mission of letting people know that you don't have to suffer unnecessarily.
Right. And to conclude, what we know about Steve Jobs was that he decided in his late 20s to become a vegetarian. And for him, vegetarianism included fake soy products, prepared, a lot of prepared foods. Just so long as he, quote, didn't eat meat or dairy, he thought he was vegetarian. He didn't embrace the whole concept of maybe raw food nutrition and getting enough enzymes and maybe being careful of, and even within a vegetarian diet, there could be GMOs, there could be gluten issues, there could be soy, there could be some other compounding factors that may not be compatible with that individual, particularly if we want to personalize a program for someone. We like to do a delayed food allergy test. Look at how your white blood cells exposed to protein antigens from over 184 different foods. If they respond in a fashion that shows an abnormal response where the white blood cells actually self-destruct initially and they release their digestive enzymes and there's a whole inflammatory cascade. To make it simply, your body's revolting, going, whoa, this is the wrong food for me. And we might say, well, why in the world is gluten included in this? We think of it as a plant-based food, but think back prior to the Egyptian times, wheat, which was the staff of life, had, I believe, barely less than 12 chromosomes. But because of what some doctors have coined is that wheat, they wanted to hybrid it so they could produce mass crops and feed more people than normally wheat could. They wanted to grow faster, quicker, and it also, by the re-engineering of the genetics, it had higher gluten content, a much higher gluten content than the original ancient wheat that we know of. And gluten is a protein, and it sometimes, in some people, can cause celiac disease. It can cause a whole host of dementia-like symptoms, memory problems, particularly massive inflammatory problems. So when I decided to create the book, Simply Healthy, which is coming out November 2nd, I wanted to create a plant-based diet that took into account, what if we design over 300 recipes that are free of gluten, free of soy, because some people have concerns about soy as well. Probably soy is a little bit too much processed, not as whole, natural superfood as it could be. And maybe we do, instead of a high oil and high viscous fat diet that can cause high triglycerides and another host of problems. There's a lot of evidence that a lot of countries, like even Italy, have a higher incidence of breast cancer due to their high olive oil intake than in, say, Vietnam or Thailand, where they don't add a lot of olive oil to their diet. And their diet is a plant-based diet. They eat less meat as well. And their incidence of breast cancer is far lower than the Italians. And we always like to tout the Mediterranean diet. We always like to say, oh, Mediterranean diet, therefore we must endorse olive oil because it's part of the Mediterranean diet. But olive oil extraction from olives is a rather new process. It's only been known about in the last few hundred years. Just like extracting corn oil out of corn, it takes 14 years of corn to make 1 tablespoon of corn oil. And it's only been since 1914 that the cold press process existed or even came about. So we have to then look back and say, are we opposed to eating fats? No, healthy fats are good for you. But super whole natural fats, particularly nuts and seeds, if they're soaked, just like in the Egyptian tombs, they found seeds in the Egyptian tombs, and when they took them out, they were still intact, and they actually exposed the seeds to moisture, and after it removed the anti-enzyme property, which prevents them from sprouting at inappropriate times, the seeds became alive after 8 hours, and they grew from 4,000 years being stored in the tombs. So we know that if we're going to eat healthy fats, we should take all nuts and seeds, chia seeds, sunflower seeds, all the walnuts, almonds, and soak them, at least overnight in water. Because nature begets the fact that that's going to promote higher enzymes, higher nutrition, the vitamin C, the B complex, the nutrients go through the roof within days of soaking and sprouting nuts and seeds. And we've done studies with animals where we've given raw nuts and seeds without soaking them, and the animals tend to develop health problems and they die sooner than the animals who have been given soaked nuts and seeds. Dr. Howell published books about enzymes. It's in the medical literature, and yet it somehow is just ignored in current day nutrition because we think, well, so long as we have, you know, a little milk for little Johnny and a little bit of oatmeal and make sure he gets his meat and his dairy product, everything's fine. Or is it fine? What's your thought?
Well, it's good that you brought that up, and I love it. I got a sneak peek of your cookbook there, and I love it, and it's needed because society's confused.
Yes.
here in San Diego, it's wonderful because there's such a health movement that a lot of people are very educated, you know, about nutrition and it's talked about. But where I grew up in Alabama, no one knows what a GMO is. No one knows what, you know, like a nut is like a pecan that falls off a tree. You know, it's like they're just not aware.
Right.
And they're confused. And they hear about all this stuff. And the number one thing that I hear all the time, well, you can't eat anything. Everything causes cancer. You know, so they just throw their hands up. And they give up. And they go to Kentucky Fried Chicken, or they go to Burger King, or they, you know, just continue doing what they're doing.
Right.
They know it's unhealthy. They can see the results, but they're confused. They don't know what to do.
Right.
So the fact that you have a guide that you can give someone, say, just follow this guide. You don't have to know about all of this stuff. Just
right.
Follow this guide. It's wonderful. So I commend you on that. It's needed. What I try to explain to people is do something that's simple yet sustainable. And I have a 70-30 rule that if you just do 70% of live foods, fruits and vegetables,
right,
you can get a little bit of the 30% wrong and it's not going to be that detrimental. But if you focus on 70% of your diet being live foods, then typically that's going to be better than 90% of general America right there. And
sure.
It's going to turn a lot of things around. And it's sustainable because that's something that people can remember.
Right.
They don't have to get caught up in the details.
Right.
Because when they get caught up in the details and become confused, they give up, they throw their hands up, and they say, well, it's just too much, and they just go back and use it as an excuse to do what they've always been doing.
And Dr. King, I have a philosophy and a belief, and that is that you're right. You don't want to confuse people. However, as you lead them down the correct pathway, it's appropriate, and we like to use hyper-focused, sensitive scripts that help people to read certain material and then just put it on their little iPhone and then play back for 20 minutes a recorded script in their own voice, because your own voice will allow your unconscious mind to accept the conditioning more appropriately than if some outside authority says some certain things that your unconscious mind critical thinking may not accept.
Mm-hmm.
But by listening to this each day, I'm going to throw you a curveball and say, well, what if they do eat raw food, but the other 30% is Kentucky Fried Chicken and Whoppers and Burger King and trying to think what. I was at Heart Attack Grill in Las Vegas,
mm-hmm.
and they sell triple bypass burgers, and they sell, you know, fries guaranteed to fry in grease to cause your arteries to clog, and they sell a milkshake that is so high in calories. They brag it's the world's highest source of calories per ounce of this milkshake of cream and grease and fat. And I guess because I've had the experience of looking under the microscope at tens of thousands of people and getting a little drop of blood after they've eaten one of these meals. And I put that under the microscope, and I remember having a couple come to my event, and they said, I'm on all raw food. I said, oh, that sounds good. And they said, yeah, and we eat a lot of raw meat too. I said, oh, that doesn't sound so good. And then I put their blood under the microscope, and it showed that there was grease in their blood. I mean, in blood is fat is very sticky like grease. And it's not so much whether it's saturated, polyunsaturated, or monounsaturated fat. It's the fat itself is highly viscous. And if you just even touch a red blood cell, there's 8 million red blood cells in the head of a pin, and that those droplets or goblets of fat last and stay in the bloodstream for 8 to 12 hours.
Mm-hmm.
So it might be appropriate initially to start off, and they're going to feel better with 70% raw food. And maybe if they're listening to a little program, say, well, why don't you get some rice? And while you're at it, maybe make it brown rice if you can order it at the restaurant. Like we did the other day at that wonderful Thai restaurant. Wasn't that to die for? It was so tasty. At least at the Heart Attack Grill, I might actually die for the food. But at the Thai restaurant, Royal Thai, up the street here in Newport Beach, it was just flavorful, tasty. We took, there was a coconut Thai soup. There was yung sen glass noodles, bean noodles, and there was, of course, we got that restaurant offers brown rice. And we got mixed vegetables cooked with little or no oil. I even gave them those instructions to do so. And there was a curry vegetable as well, and I think eggplant or something on that order.
And there was nothing missing. I mean, you know, you had every flavor that you wanted.
Right.
You didn't miss any type of meat or say, oh, if it just had this, or it was perfect. It was
now, awesome. I got to admit, if we were in Alabama, I'm not sure if a Thai food restaurant would go over well. I don't know. You tell me. I've only passed through Alabama on my way to Florida, but you tell me.
Well, and that's the thing. You mentioned it. Starting out, and the beautiful thing about the 70-30, okay, is it's not the end point.
It's the beginning.
It's the entry point.
Entry point. Got it.
Okay?
Okay.
And when you enter in, you know, when you do, if you're able to go from eating mostly meats, eating mostly fried foods and all that, and if you're actually able to achieve doing 70% raw, that's huge.
That's huge.
So if you're able to do that, well, guess what the 30% is going to be?
I don't know.
It's not going to be fried chicken.
I hope not.
Well, because a person that has accomplished such focus to be able to accomplish that 70%, now they're in that conscious mind.
Yeah.
You know, they're being conscious about everything that they're eating. So they're going to make better choices about the 30.
Right.
And so now that they're making better choices about the 30, then they only have 30% to improve upon rather than 100% of what they're doing every day.
In practicality, I agree. I'll never forget my grandfather once said this. He said, Nick, and I was very young, and he was teaching me how he built a mechanic shop, and he worked repair shop and a metal factory, or you could create metal parts, and he owned a hotel, not hotels, but apartment homes, and he came straight from Mexico, from zero, and he built this up, you know, became, you know, who he was in LA, and he said, Nick, he said, you're trying to make a change, right? And I said, yes. And he said, well, what if you had a cat and you had a long tail? You think you'd be easier on the cat if you just cut off his tail at an inch at a time, or you just cut it off right there? I couldn't understand the analogy. I'm like, well, let me think. What's the difference between an inch at a time and one swoop? Well, one swoop, man. The pain's over. It's done. One swoop versus ow, ow, ow. But humans are different. We need time to adapt. I get it. Mm-hmm. So the cat may not apply.
Well, the difference is between the cat is someone else is cutting off their tail.
Okay. So you're right. The conscious mind. And that's where I get back to. The reason I believe that 95% of, quote, diets fail is because they're trying to deal with literally hundreds of advertisements, thousands of commercials. I know when I was a kid, I used to sit in front of the television. My little four-year-old, I rarely ever let him watch television, but man, if he's in front of it, he's just... you know, and every little thing he's picking up. Today he said, and he was telling you this today, he said, I created, and he got a little sealed container of water, half water, and soap, and he said, see bubbles. I'm going to sell airbubbles.com. He's 4 years old, and he's already marketing airbubbles.com. I said, where did you get the .com? He said, I heard it on television. I'm like, we all get so much, and now with this day of the internet, I mean, there's just this massive amount of conditioning. Now, we might argue, well, the internet, at least we can kind of negotiate what we watch, whereas before it was television programming.
Not really.
There's programming going on. I mean, I'm watching Yahoo, and then in the corner, I'm looking at my email, and there's these ads keep springing up, you know? I'm like, I don't want to look at that, you know? But I think that if you help people to recondition that conscious thinking, my belief is if you really help the mind to accept some new programming, that it truly is okay to eat brown rice at a Thai restaurant and whole fresh foods and not order the meat dish and not order the cream, the Thai iced tea, and, you know, and make some selections, some conscious decisions. But at the unconscious level, initially, all of us as humans, we initially respond by our unconscious conditioning, and that's our first choice. Yeah, I don't mind. I'll just get the Coca-Cola anyway. I'm at the movie theater. Good friends who are pretty health-oriented. Yeah, I'll get the popcorn anyway. Oh, really? How often are you going to go to the movie set? How often are you going to eat the greasy popcorn? Mm-hmm. You know, and then maybe a hot dog to go with it and a Coca-Cola? Mm-hmm. I don't know, but we've all been conditioned when you go to the ballpark, you know, the baseball game. What is it? It's hot dogs and whatever. We go to weddings, and it's the feast. It's the cake. I have the audacity to when I have birthday parties, to use vegan ice cream, low fat, to go ahead and get whole food cakes, you know, gluten free, and put a frosting that's sugar free and fat free, and it's right in my cookbook, my Simply Healthy cookbook. And people say, people aren't going to eat that, and then they taste it, they go, this is actually pretty good.
Absolutely.
And it's all about helping people see. You can duplicate virtually any food you can imagine with the right recipe, the right flavor. I say it's all about the sauces. I mean, my biggest downfall was when I did transition to eating vegetables and fresh brown rice and so forth. I was still eating meat, and I was terrified because I was a weightlifter, a football competitor, and then later I went into strength endurance competition. And in my mind, I thought, I can't imagine not getting enough protein without eating fish and chicken and egg whites. I mean, I was terrified to think I had to give that up, so I didn't. I stuck with that. I still ate my vegetables and all the other things, but at the end of a year, my cholesterol level would not come down. And I was concerned because I had already had one stroke and I was only 23 years old, because I'd eaten so much meat, 12 eggs a day, to bulk up to play football, that TIA, that transient ischemic attack, just was looming over my head and said, I gotta do something drastic. And I one night I just said, I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna give up the chicken, the fish, the turkey, and the egg whites. And egg whites were okay, but you know, I'd already given up the egg yolks. And I'm just gonna go completely. And I got to tell you, it was a turmoil in me. It was like, I almost made that comment, well, it's almost not worth doing it, you know, to have to eat that drastically.
So did you go vegetarian or did you go vegan? And explain to people what the difference is.
Well, a vegetarian, by definition, could be lacto-ovo vegetarian. They could be eating eggs and all vegetarian and no meat. They could be still consuming dairy product at times, and some people consider themselves semi-vegetarian in that category. Vegan is simply, it's completely no fish, no chicken, no turkey, no dairy product, no animal product whatsoever. And we say this, if it had legs, wings, could wiggle or move, it has cholesterol and it's an animal product, and don't eat it. If it had roots and it grew, it's fine, it's a plant food, and it's open game, it's a vegan, basis to the diet. So when I made that change, the first day I'm thinking, how do I go an entire day without meat? I mean, I couldn't even fathom. What do you do? There's always a meat in my lunch and meat in the sandwich. There's a meat on the plate. And there's meat at dinner. You know, chicken, you have fish, and there's vegetables and potato and rice. And I just thought, I gotta figure this out here. So first I said, well, I guess I could eat bean and rice burritos. There's no meat, no cheese. I can do that. And I can even drive through a restaurant, order it the same way. No cheese, I'd say proudly. And just give me the bean burrito. And sometimes they had rice on the side. I look in the car, so throw the rice in too. And if they had potato in one of the other dishes, maybe you can slip potato in there too. And then put the salsa on it, maybe get a side dinner salad and put that in there. And I get corn tortillas sometimes instead of the flour tortillas, so I'd have my own soft tacos. And I said, well, there's one meal down. And it was one meal at a time. I guess it's like Alcoholics Anonymous, one drink at a time, one day at a time. And every meal, I just painstakingly tried to figure out what could I do. What I ended up doing, quite honestly, was I started collecting recipe books from all over, all international cuisines. Mm. And I thought, well, maybe within the Thai recipe book, there's a recipe I could eat. Maybe in that Chinese recipe book, maybe in the Mediterranean, Italian one, and Mexican. And one by one, I looked, literally, I have hundreds of cookbooks, literally, that I've collected over the years. I just love cooking, personally. So as I looked through all these recipes and said, oh, that one worked, and I compiled over 300 recipes. In fact, it was over 600 recipes in the initial cookbook I published, which was 400 pages long. But I wanted to bring that cookbook back, but I noticed over 30 years ago when I did that first cookbook, it had, some of the dishes had soy, some of the dishes had gluten wheat, some had, whatever the oil, too much fat in it. So I had to re-engineer it. So I got down to my 300 favorite recipes. That's how Simply Healthy came about. Mm-hmm. And that's what's being released this month.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful.
I look forward to eating every day. It's exciting to me. And I realized it was in the sauces. that most international cuisines depend on chilies and spices and cumin and celery and dill and all these wonderful spices. So to be a good cook to me isn't, you know, I went through Cordon Bleu and I learned how to make the most fattiest, you know, rib and this and that and sauces. I want to educate people that maybe cooking is an art and you can artfully eat healthy. It's important. You've hung out with me the last couple of days. You see, we worked out together. Do you see me eating a bunch of protein to build up?
I love the foods. I'm the perfect example of someone who has a goal to eat vegan. However, if a chicken crosses me wrong, I'm eating. I have a seafood diet. I eat what I see. So I have to control what I see. I have to control within biting range. And so what I do is I make sure that my surroundings are such that's going to support me. And that's kind of how I've had to transition. Because when I first decided, when I read the China study, yeah. I decided I'm not going to eat meat ever again. There's no way that you can read that book and then want to eat meat after that.
Right.
And then every so often I would slip and I would eat some meat and it would stress me out. And I would get upset and it would cause a reaction in my body. And as you know, you know, when you get stressed and when you cause negative emotions and when you have that negative emotion centering around whatever you're focused on at the moment, it's not good. You know, certain hormones get released and everything like that. That can be just as harmful as eating the wrong things. And so I had to really set myself up to win. And so I outlined what my goal was, and I just worked towards that goal.
Right.
And as I became more and more knowledgeable of my options,
right,
then it became easier. As it became easier, I enjoy good food better. My definition of what good food was changed.
Sure.
And it was a gradual process. And now, you know, I think I probably started out 70-30, then 80-20. I'm probably 90-10 probably right now, I would say.
That's a tremendous
right. And that 10% are, you know, fish-based products.
I did write an article that you can look up on the web, Is Fish Healthy? And it definitely bears reading, particularly with Fukushima. And legitimately, I predicted more than 2 years ago the radiation fallout. It's probably going to be worse than Chernobyl was. And Chernobyl accounted for over 1 million deaths. The reason that people don't get hysterical and concerned is because these heavy radiation particles that enter into the ocean, into airspace, and into the water, they end up in the gills of fish or, you know, in various things that fish eat. And when you consume them, those hot particles, it's no longer the fact that the original nuclear reactor is spewing out radiation that, you know, we can't see, but it's penetrating through our body. No, it's worse. Those radioactive particles have been spewed into the environment, polluting the Pacific Ocean worse than any pollution occurrence in history. To the point where, just to put it in perspective, there was about 4 pounds of plutonium, the most toxic substance known on the planet, the world that we know of. And Hiroshima, which did kill 250,000 people almost instantly in the fall after the number of deaths was even higher, it really only took 4 pounds of plutonium plus, you know, depleted uranium. There's a lot of spin-offs from various radioactive particles. Cesium, radioactive iodine, which we know causes thyroid cancer. The problem is that these particles lodge in these fish, in the gills, and then when you eat them, a particle goes into your body. And I've actually looked at imaging in medical textbooks, and you see in the early days when they were doing the Alamo study, when they were looking at people working with radioactive particles, and some of them got exposed. And fortunately, our skin will protect us from alpha radiation. But if we swallow it, there's no protection.
Mm-hmm.
And So I actually bought a little canary radioactive particle detector, and I'll point it out, push the little button, it goes tick, 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 like a you know, Geiger counter. And if there's radioactive particles, it goes tick, 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 tick. Whoa, we ain't gonna eat that.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm finding it in seaweed and certain fish and so forth. And I'm like, oh, wow. And then I even found it in certain other foods that you wouldn't expect, and it made sense because I started checking the general research on, you know, how these particles are concentrating in certain foods and environments. So, in the reality is that I'm moving towards hydroponic foods. I buy more of those, you know, lettuces that are grown,
mm-hmm.
and they're under little tents. And Optimum Health, they do it this way,
mm-hmm.
and it's own contained, so there's no particles that could spew down onto the land or into the water. The water's controlled. And you're growing plants and you're not exposed to any kind of heavy metals or radioactive particles or anything. But the concern that we have is the number of birth defects, the number of childhood cancers, the number of leukemias. I just heard a report that and this is on Google, so it's public knowledge, but the president of Subway has leukemia right now and is being treated, and it doesn't sound too good. So we look at this, and I had a choice. I knew when Fukushima occurred, I took my whole family to the East Coast. I went to Florida, and we hung out there when the original, you know, incident occurred, waiting to see if more reactors were going to be shut down or if it would be controlled. In Russia, in Chernobyl, what they did, you know what they did to control the meltdown there?
Okay.
They brought a million soldiers, Russian soldiers, and they buried in cement the radioactive radioactive plant. They buried it completely, but it took a million soldiers and it took an act of the whole country to do it. In Japan, you know what they've done to stop the shutdown and the spewing of these radioactive heavy particles in the last 2 years?
What?
Nothing.
Mm.
And it's still spewing out. And the amount of particles, you say, well, it's a big ocean and the particles won't last too long. They only stay in the environment 200,000 years.
Wow.
So we have a problem. And I truly had a choice. I was either going to move to South America, which I understood that the air streams and the water streams and the, you know, the particles would not reach South America. And I researched it closely and thought, And then I found evidence it's reaching South America still. So I said, okay, what do I got to do? We're all exposed to things that can cause cancer. Every day, I mean, there's certain things. I mean, there's probably 1,600 chemicals in the environment now that we're exposed to that we weren't even exposed to when we were kids.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought, well, I'm going to figure out how to build up my body. I'm going to take certain supplements, eat a certain way, exercise a certain way, and do certain things that I will give myself a fighting chance. I could go into some underground, you know, radioactive fallout. Live there the rest of my life like in a bubble. That's not my style.
Mm-hmm.
I'd rather go surfing, hang out, and figure out how to beat this thing.
Mm-hmm.
So we're all up against a very serious amount. But I'm not going to go out of my way personally to eat fish because I know that's a very toxic source.
Mm-hmm.
And the risk is much higher, let alone the high risk of mercury. Dr. Chris Shade, who studied this radioactive exposure and also studies a lot about autism and the sources of mercury and heavy metals, he'll tell you that when you eat tuna, within 1 day of eating the tuna, your mercury levels that go into your body spike, like off the charts, that they're measurable and they're retained in your body, in the fatty tissue. It never leaves, unless you know how to detoxify it. So we're looking at these methods, and the very same methods that detoxify heavy metals are very likely going to be successful in detoxifying nuclear fallout and radioactive particles. The scary thing is that it was hushed up. And everyone's acting like, oh, no worse than a chest x-ray. Really? Now you're starting to see the reports coming out and verifying what I said over 2 years ago, that these particles are a serious danger to all of us. And somehow, we've got to get a message back. I spoke in Tokyo in 2006. I would never go to Japan at this stage. But I said that, but then realizing this stuff spewing out into the whole environment. I said this at a public lecture 2 years ago, and half the audience left. And I thought, that's pretty depressing to think about it. But I don't think that anything that we run away from is something that's going to solve the situation. I think, you know, as a culture, we have to figure out how to handle we were under the mistaken belief we could control nuclear power. And somehow we keep springing up plants. And they did shut out all the plants for about a year, I think it was, certain plants that they suspected. And now we have one down in our backyard here where I like to surf in San Onofre. And they say it's a little bit of stuff showing up, leaking out. Well, a little bit of stuff is not good. I mean, it doesn't take much. It only takes a few particles to cause cancer. So cancer is a serious risk to all of us, and I don't think we can ignore it any longer. And I also think that it's a tragedy that we're all led to believe all we have to do is go see the oncologist, the radioactive specialist, radiation specialist. And it almost seems counterintuitive. Why would you give someone radiation, which we know causes cancer? Why would you give someone radiation treatment when they already have cancer? And why would you give them chemotherapy agents that are so toxic, like in the case of AZT, which was used in AIDS patients recently? They banned it after its failure in cancer patients, and it killed so many people. And yet, we expose AIDS patients to it because it's a multi-billion-dollar industry. I hate to deal with conspiracy theories, but Dr. Peter Duesberg at UC Berkeley, he'll tell you the same thing. He wrote a textbook this thick, about 800 pages documented. Three Nobel Prize laureates said that AIDS is an invented disease that's not sexually transmitted, contrary to popular belief. And it basically is two causes. You know what the two causes of AIDS are, or death associated with what we think to be AIDS? Only two. One is in Africa, there's starvation. And they're too poor to do the AIDS block test and to even test for it. So they can't really say that people dying of AIDS and after dying of AIDS. Mm. The reality is, it's more popular to get money for research to say, hey, these people in Africa are dying, and it's not so popular to say they're dying of starvation. Somehow we've turned a cold ear to starvation. And yet, if we hear it's AIDS and maybe we can cure it in Africa before it gets over here, then maybe we'll throw some money at it and solve the problem. We know it's starvation, and it's not AIDS as we know it, sexually transmitted. And why? Because in Europe, when there was an increased rate in so-called deaths from AIDS, concurrently there was a high increased use in amyl nitrates and various drugs that are associated with homosexuals using it to stay up all night and have sex, poppers and so forth. So they would wipe out their immune system. And we knew these exact drugs, these not prescription, but just recreational drugs, were causing deaths that would have caused deaths even if they had never been diagnosed with AIDS. And we know this to be true too, because in New York there's a subgroup of vegan, vegetarian homosexuals that don't stay up all night partying, they don't take drugs, they take care of their health, and they have no incidence of death, zero, associated with AIDS, even though they're in a high risk population. So he went further and he said that AIDS virus cannot replicate over a 20-year period. In other words, it has a latency period of 20 years. You know from textbooks in epidemiology, if someone's contracted measles, there's a certain number of days before it reaches a peak and then it disappears. Same with mumps, right? Same with every known infectious disease, except for AIDS. How could it have a 20-year latency period and show up 20 years later after someone's infected? Impossible. And this is what three Nobel Prize laureates have said. But no one wants to debate them because it's very big money for the amount of research coming in to those who profess that they know the cure for AIDS or they're searching for the cure for AIDS and AIDS research. But it's very unpopular to say that you could cure AIDS by getting all the drug users off the drugs, get them on a healthy lifestyle and an exercise program, and certainly practice safe sex. There are other sexually transmitted diseases that are not too nice. But at least to the extent that we're fearful of AIDS, and like you said, fear. Mm-hmm. So they use a drug that's so toxic that it will kill you. Even Magic Johnson, I know one of the physicians that approached it and explained exactly what I'm telling you. Magic Johnson is alive today. Why? He never took AZT. He follows a healthy lifestyle, and he's invested in the Dodgers. He's one of the most successful businessmen that we know. I mean, we all can admire what he's accomplished. So I think we have to relook at what chronic diseases, infectious diseases, and really look back. I mean, it's the same thing with antibiotics. Wasn't there a concurrent time when antibiotics were developed about the same time that we figured out how to clean water for the general population. And the incidence of death associated with infectious diseases curtailed almost immediately concurrently when they figured out how to clean the aqueducts and the water and so forth. So it wasn't so much attributed to antibiotics. And antibiotics has its place occasionally. But the fact that we use so many antibiotics for everything, there's super bugs now showing up. Mm-hmm. What's your opinion about what's going on with that?
Well, let me speak a little bit about the AIDS thing first. You gave a lot of information there. When you label someone as having a terminal illness and they believe it,
yes,
that alone will cause a syndrome.
Absolutely.
That alone will cause them to go down the path where their body deteriorates.
Right.
Because they believe that they believe that they're going to die. When you put a healthy person in the hospital and you put a hospital gown on a person and you put them in a bed, they become ill. And so, you know, my patients that come into the hospital, I tell them, bring pajamas. Don't wear the hospital gown. Because there's
sexy pajamas?
There's an association with that hospital gown.
Sure.
That you're ill.
Right.
And so the first step that I have to do with people is to convince them that they are not ill.
It's powerful.
They have an obstacle, they have a challenge. But they're not ill. Get rid of the hospital gown, you know, put on some clothes that are going to give you some dignity, right? Not your ass blowing in the wind.
Right.
And get well and get out of here. And I think that when the people in Africa, mm-hmm. you know, if they're suffering from starvation and someone labels them as having AIDS,
right.
Well, instantly they're going to adopt the symptoms and the syndrome
right.
of AIDS and pass away. So I think that has really impacted third world countries.
To my understanding, the reported literature shows that every hospital worker has worked with AIDS patients, which they're exposed to someone coughing on them, their excrement, their urine, their blood at times probably. Not one case, to my knowledge, according to the reports by Peter Duisberg in several medical journal textbooks, says, has ever a medical worker with an AIDS patient ever contracted AIDS? And if it's sexually transmitted, okay, maybe they didn't have sex with them, but how could they ignore body fluids exchanging? It happens. I mean, you know, just thinking back to your medical residency, oops, I stuck myself with the darn needle after I just did whatever. It happens.
Mm-hmm.
I know it happens. I've seen it happen. But that's interesting. The other thing is that during Europe, when they started educating them about massive illicit drug use, when they got them convinced to stop using the drugs, the rate of AIDS dropped drastically.
Mm-hmm.
Was that a coincidence?
Mm-hmm.
Or was it related truly to cleaning up their act when it came to using illegal drugs or illicit drugs and things that truly depress the immune system? And really, it comes back full circle. Cancer, AIDS, it is the immune system. And we have the most amazing immune system.
Mm-hmm.
We have soldiers, we have white blood cells, we have killer NT cells. I mean, we look under the microscope, we see this.
Mm-hmm.
But we also see what can depress the immune system.
Mm-hmm.
And we know what can enhance it. So maybe our battle line should be earlier in the stage. Or if it does develop, maybe take a whole new approach.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I remember reading once there was a hospital, and the hospital name escapes me, but it was one of these, it was right across the archway. Through these doors, when you pass in this hospital, no one dies. Everyone leaves healthy. And their philosophy was what you just said.
Mm-hmm.
Don't condition them. No one leaves these doors. It's mm-hmm. everyone successfully leaves these doors.
Mm-hmm.
You are conditioned from the moment you step into this hospital. We're going to get you well, and in your best interest, we're going to get you out of here. That's
mm-hmm.
incredible that you're
mm-hmm.
doing that.
And so I think that we could spend hours talking about what's wrong. The uplifting thing
mm-hmm.
is that there's only a few principles that you can learn to do what's right. The what's right is a lot more simple than the what's wrong. And so when you talk about everything that's going on with the government and the healthcare system, with the antibiotics, with the pharmaceuticals, radiation, with pollution, with, I mean, all these things. We could go on and on and on.
It could get depressing.
It could get very depressing. To the point where
we just give up, throw up our hands, what the heck? Can't do anything anyway.
Exactly.
Not true, though.
Absolutely not true. And there's simple things
that's right.
that you can do. That's why I love the fact that your book has simple in it. Mine does too, simple yet sustainable. And there's simple things that you can do to protect yourself.
Yes.
There's simple things that you can do to arm your mind. There's simple things that you can do to arm your body. And by keeping it simple, by keeping it fun, by feeding your spirit, by feeding your mind, by feeding your body, stuff that's going to support you, I think that we could really protect ourselves and protect our families and influence from starting with ourselves and spreading it to others. And I think that's important.
So what are the 7 steps, briefly, that people can arm themselves with to strengthen their body and their mind?
The first step is clarity. A lot of people want to be healthy, they want to lose weight, or they want more energy, but they're not clear on exactly what they want. I could say I want to lose weight. Well, if I lose, you know, 5 pounds, I've done it, right? Well, that's not helping me much if I weigh 250 pounds. So be clear. Know exactly what your ideal body weight is. Know exactly what you want to accomplish with that. Know exactly, you know, to the decimal point of what you want your weight to be.
Is it a good question to ask people, what did you weigh in high school or college? It's likely, if they were in good shape, it's likely that they were close to their ideal body weight around that time.
Depends on how old they are. If, you know, they grew up in our generation, that is true.
Yes.
If they grew up in this generation, that is not true.
You're right. You can't even go to the beach anymore and see even young people who are in good shape, unless they're out surfing, right, and really battling the waves and then they're ripped abs, you know. I go out surfing, I'm not stupid, I think surfing's great exercise, you know, or they're playing volleyball all day, or they're sitting back on the beach drinking the beer and eating the Kentucky Fried Chicken.
Right, absolutely.
It is a generational issue.
I remember I took my niece to college for her freshman year. I probably was in my 30s at the time. And so I was going to take her, she was going to Alabama A&M, historically black university in Alabama. And I was excited, and I went to Alabama State University, another HBCU. And so I was so excited, because I remember my first day, you know, on the college campus. And it was just all about the women. I never saw so many women before in one place ever, right? So I was like, oh, I'm taking her to college, I'm going to see all these women. I'm ready. Got on campus and looked around, and it was the most depressing thing that I've ever seen. Here you had freshman girls, 200 pounds.
Sure.
And that was almost the norm. It's like everyone was overweight. And I was looking around, I'm like, this is before the freshman 15. You know, so like, where are they going from there? They're starting out obese.
Right.
It was just so depressing. And so, you know, so your question is, you know, where were you when you were in high school or college? You know, it depends. It depends on what generation.
Point well taken.
Yeah.
I know when I went to Japan, and virtually everywhere you look, everyone was in great shape. Mm-hmm. You couldn't find a fat Japanese person. Mm-hmm. Except where you went into the food court and there was a McDonald's and there was a line of people, and in that line there were the only fat, and I'm going to use the term fat, I'll say obese, overweight, whatever politely you want to say, because I used to be fat, grossly overweight, over 200 pounds, and so I know what it was like to be most of my younger life, except for a brief period where I starved myself to play football, I was overweight, I was very, very heavy and clinically obese, over 25% body fat. So I know from coming from a fat mentality, a mindset that I never got rid of my oversized clothes, because I thought, even if I lose the weight, in my mind I thought I better keep it. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't until there was a point where I finally changed my mind about my lifestyle and said, this is the way I choose to live the rest of my life. And not only did I decide that I would get healthier and be fitter every year, I exceeded my wildest dreams about it. Now to the point where I'm using these hyper-focus eyes open hypnosis scripts, where we have over 60 scripts, and we start off with a few scripts with each of our clients, and as they read them and play them back in their little phones and so forth, they get a message that reinforces and helps them to overcome all these years of past conditioning, mm-hmm. where they truly can see themselves past that belief that they'll never reach their ideal weight, to the point where it kind of happens overnight. After a week or two of doing it, they go, I notice I'm not craving or wanting to order these things that I used to eat. I'm actually desiring to order fruit and vegetables and fresh brown rice and healthy food. Mm-hmm. And that's how it happens. It would be far easier. And I challenge anyone listening, because I know I went through a struggle to make the change. You went through a struggle to make the change. Mm-hmm. Let's make their life simple. Let's make it easy and give them the tools. And that's what we've done with the protocol. Give them the tools that we know, instead of the 95% failure rate, we want 100% success rate. Just like when they pass through those hospital doors and go, everyone succeeds mm-hmm. in coming through these doors. Because this is a different kind of hospital.
Right.
It's a wellness approach.
And what's important is they have to reach threshold first.
They got to hit bottom first?
Well, not necessarily, bottom, but threshold. When someone wants to make a change in their life, there's something that happens. There's a moment that they say enough is enough.
They're going back to a reunion. They're going to a wedding.
They
have a new love in their life.
It could be.
They're starting sports.
Or they develop a pain. Or they, there's just something. There's that straw that breaks the camel back that makes them say enough is enough. And so that brings to step number two. Step number two is leverage. So getting people to that leverage, because unless you have enough pain in your, in your current state, you're not going to change. And so helping them to find that pain, helping them to get threshold quicker so they can seek out the tools, is very important.
So there are move towards and move away goals. I mean, I knew the move away would be, I want to move away from being fat or move away from being in pain. And that's a great motivator, no doubt about it. However, in the long run, the move toward goal of, I just want to feel better. I want to look better. I want to do it for myself, not because my spouse or my kids want me to, or mm-hmm. my mom wants me to. I want to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And so my concern is that the first heart attack is the last heart attack. In over 50% of the cases, they have no known origin. They've never maybe done a peripheral vascular study or scan or ultra-fast CT scan. They don't know there's plaques in their arteries. But I assure you, if they've been on the Western way of eating, even fish and chicken is clogging their arteries right now. So we need to do something to alert those people. At least they can make an intelligent decision, and maybe the turning point is a carotid scan that shows, oh, here I thought I was healthy, but I have plaques marks like I first found out. Mm-hmm. I couldn't believe it.
And that may be that piece of threshold, when they actually see that. Absolutely.
Right. And with medical technology, we can detect these things. Don't wait till you have the diagnosis and you already have the stroke or heart attack.
Mm-hmm.
Come in and do a full-on executive review, hormones, lab tests, blood tests. That's what I do for people. I want to get leverage for them. So mm-hmm. see your blood on the screen,
right.
See your lipid levels, see your arteries, look at your risk factors, look at the changes, and look at the oxidative stress, the risk of cancer, mm-hmm. or at least, I can't say cancer, but I can say changes in the cellular health.
Mm-hmm.
So what do we need to do? Get leverage. I like mm-hmm. that. What's next?
Developing or tapping into your power personality. So when we were able to accomplish big things in our life, big goals, things that we didn't think that we were able to do, we had a certain mentality.
Mm-hmm.
We had a certain mentality, and we tapped into that before, we decided that we couldn't do it or got told no too often. And so I help people, find that, tap back into that power personality. And usually we have to go back and identify something that they were able to accomplish.
Right.
And go back into who you were at that time and actually give it a name, and then call that person out to accomplish this goal. Okay. And so that's the third step. The fourth step is the knowledge. So after you go through that process, the knowledge to be able to do it, is the fourth thing. A lot of people start out with the knowledge first, and that's why they sit on the knowledge and don't do anything.
Right.
Right. We're in a state of information overload,
right,
that people, you know, don't use. Once you have the knowledge, fifth step is the rituals. People are a product of their daily rituals, also called habits. And when you are able to develop certain things that you do every day, then your body and your mind will reflect that. And over time, that's when you're able to hit your goals, is because of the things that you do every single day. And so we help people develop those rituals. And once you have the rituals, you have to be able to sustain it. It has to be sustainable. And so you have to have a process. Things that allow people to sustain their rituals are getting in an environment that supports those daily rituals. You know, maybe moving out of Alabama to San Diego, joining a mastermind group, joining a Facebook group, people that are like-minded, or developing an accountability.
That's why our people are here.
Yes.
They're interested in making those huge changes and learning from people who have done it.
Absolutely.
Be around people who are right on track.
Absolutely.
And notch it up a few levels, you know. I mean, why not go for the world champions, the superheroes? I mean, that's when I first met Dragan Radovich. He was the world's strongest strength endurance athlete, never been beat. I wanted a model, and I wanted to beat him. I knew if I could and would, that things would happen in a big way. Same with Nathan Pritikin, the greatest researcher, nutritional expert. I spent years just studying with him, Terry Hertog, about hormone therapy. Each person, and what we need to do is then look at how we make this complex information simple and reproducible. And I think that the part that I like is that we have a script for each one of these things. People can read, how do you increase your energy? And it's just a short 15-minute script to 20 minutes. You read through it, and you start picking the things that empower you with energy, not depending on coffee or depending on some extreme ways to get energy, but the natural ways to build up energy. And I build that within the scripts that people will read in our anti-aging makeover program. We build in, you know, how to become a good public speaker. Some people are terrified. I mean, they say it's more scary to some people than death, they say. Mm-hmm. It's like, really? You know, you learn, you get yourself out in front, and you talk, and mm-hmm. there's certain things within the script that prepares you for mm-hmm. that.
And that fits right along into making it sustainable.
Yes.
The last thing, probably one of the most important things, is the investment. People have have goals and they want to accomplish something in their life, but then they may not be willing to invest, not just money, but invest their time, invest their emotions. The more you pay, the more you pay attention. Small businesses, there's a difference between hobbies, small business, and big business. Hobbies, people don't really invest much. You don't really invest much money. You may not invest too much time. Definitely don't invest a lot of emotions. Small business, you invest a small amount of money, right? Big business, invest a large amount of money,
right?
And that's the same way with goals. If you have a very large goal, you have to really make a large investment. And it does not necessarily have to be money, but it definitely should be a combination of finances, time, and emotion.
Right.
And that locks you in. And feeds into everything that you're, going to do to make sure that you succeed in that.
Right.
So those are the seven steps.
That's awesome. I think a few announcements. We're going to take a short break, but we have an event coming up November 2nd, Saturday, in Newport Beach. Mark Victor Hansen will be there. We just got that announcement. Nurka of Law of Supreme Influence, her book, and I'll be speaking there. And then I'll be at your event in middle November.
Yes, November 15th, 16th, 17th.
In the San Diego area.
Absolutely. Conquering Age, which you know a lot about.
We're going after it.
And we're bringing a dynamic team. Yourself is included. I call you all my vitality partners.
Right.
To come and so people can learn from the experts. And we're going to have an awesome time at that event, three-day event San Diego.
Looking forward to it. We're going to take a break and come back and answer a few more questions.